Welcome back to the next video on my YouTube channel, still about kinematics. Today I want to finalize the explanation of the superposition principle, as I have explained it last time, by calculating some more examples. So imagine there is a boat that wants to cross the Yukon River in Canada from the south to the north, as explained in this exercise. So the river flows from the west to the east, which leads to a drift of the boat of approximately 3 kilometers to the east. The distance between the two river banks is given as 2 kilometers at that specific position. So the boat travels with a speed of 5 kilometers per hour, now also written in the exercise. So the question is now, what is the speed of the river? So before we start with the solution of this exercise, it is always a good idea to make a sketch of this whole of the whole description, and this sketch is shown here. I introduced here the letters B for the width of the river, S for the drift of the boat, V stands for the velocity of the boat, and U stands for the velocity of the river. Because both velocities and distance vectors are completely perpendicular to each other, they can be treated independently from each other, which means that basically for us it is completely sufficient to take only the absolute values of these quantities into account. First, we calculate the traveling time of the boat that I denoted here with a capital T, and this equals to B over V. I have used the capital letter T in order to emphasize on the fact that we really use the description of a certain time interval. So we could now insert basically the values of B and V in order to get a number for T, for capital T, but let me introduce a little bit better and more elegant way to solve this. We write down the formula for the distance S equal to U times T as shown there for the drift of the boat. We can then insert the first equation into the second one and replace the time T in that formula. So the resulting equation can then be solved for the unknown variable U, which leads to U equal to S over B times V. Inserting then all results inserting then all values into that formula results in a speed of 1.2 km per hour for the river. This is more elegant than just inserting numbers into equations because of rounding errors. Before we start with the next topic that I want to discuss in this video, I want to go back to the description of vector quantities, just very shortly. As I said last time, we call the vector velocity and the magnitude, which means the absolute value of this vector, the speed of an object. The term distance, however, and this is shown in this table here, describes only the magnitude of a vector that is called displacement. So, since I have forgotten to mention that in the last video, I just want to clarify this matter now, and I also promise, like last time, that I will always stick to this definition in the future. So, when we talk about the distance between two points and we use the vector quantity, then I will always refer to the displacement and not to the distance. Now, as you remember, we have only concentrated on objects so far traveling with a constant velocity, V is equal to const. We can illustrate this with an ST diagram or a distance time diagram as shown here, where the resulting graph is simply a straight line because V is constant. The fraction delta S over delta T, and this is also shown here, is then just given as the slope of that line, as displayed here also inside this graph. Now we want to generalize this idea a little bit to calculate the velocity. In the case in which V is not constant, but instead by itself a function of T. In this case, we cannot just simply draw a straight line between two points, because this would lead just to an average velocity, as I explained in one of the first videos. if we want to obtain the momentary velocity, we have to make the interval, the time interval, very short, so much short until it really sticks, or until it really becomes an infinitesimal small time interval. Mathematically, this means that we have to calculate basically the limit of delta t over delta of delta s over delta t, with delta t approaching to zero, and this is shown here. This is also, now you can see why it was beneficial to use this delta style of writing this fraction, because the limit of delta t approaching zero is just equal to the derivative of s with respect to the variable t. And then this can be written as, you can see here, the fraction ds over dt, so we just substitute delta s with ds and delta t with dt. Usually physicists prefer this way of writing the derivative. Other possibilities are, as you can see here, to write it like s prime of t. This is normally done in schools in such a way, or simply s dot for the derivative, especially with respect to the variable t for the time. Now we take a look at the vector quantity v. As I explained last time, if a vector is divided by a constant, every component has to be divided by that constant, yeah? Individually. So in this, in case of the derivative, it is completely similar to that. Every component of the vector r has to be differentiated with respect to t as presented here. So you have to calculate for v dx over dt, dy over dt, and dz over dt in case of a three-dimensional movement. In the next step, we want to learn how to calculate the distance if v is given. First, we take a look at the so-called velocity time, or shortly vt diagram, as shown here. If v is constant, we just draw a flat line. I have already explained before, or last time, that then in this case, s is just given as the product of v and t. The distance can then be just interpreted in this diagram as the area under that line, v times t. This way of understanding a product is very important when we go to the next step, when we assume that v is again a function of t, because then the vt diagram looks, for example, as presented here, for just an arbitrary function, v of t. If we stick to the interpretation that the distance is the area under the graph, then we can just divide this area into a specific number of n small pieces with the width delta t. And if we make this very, very small, then at the end we have to sum up all these small areas in order to get the complete area. If we make these intervals very, very small, which means basically infinitesimal small, then this sum here turns into an integral. So if we want to calculate the distance from an arbitrary movement with a velocity which is not constant, we have to integrate over the function v from the start point s1 from the start point at the time t1 until the end point at the time t2. Keeping this in mind, makes the calculation of velocities and displacements in principle very simple, because you just have to replace the fraction by a derivative and the product by the integral. Of course, the last step of deriving the integral is not necessary if you know already that the integral is just the inverse function of the derivative. Another possibility I want to show now, an alternative how to derive this, with the fraction ds over dt, it can be easily written as v equal to ds over dt, and then solving that equation for ds, yeah, which leads then to ds equal to v times dt. Integrating ds from s1 to s2 gives simply the distance s as a result, whereas the integral over v remains. Yeah? So therefore, we get again the same formula, s is equal to the integral over v dt. This is only an alternative to derive the previously mentioned function, as I said before. And please keep in mind that this is only the way how maybe a physicist would do this. Because we sometimes, me including, treat this derivative just as a fraction. For a mathematician, of course, this method would not work. You cannot treat it basically as a real fraction, so in order to really calculate the derivative and from that the integral becomes a little bit more complicated and more advanced, but for the time being we will only stick to the point of view that it is just a derivative, it's just a fraction. Now here I want to stop for the time being. I hope that this video was again very informative for you and beneficial. I hope it was possible now to understand this not so complicated matter a little bit deeper. Now I think we have learned all the tools that are necessary to introduce the acceleration in the next video, where we will also see that every object falls down with the same acceleration near the Earth's surface. So I can only say for the time being, please stay tuned. Don't forget to subscribe to this channel if you don't want to miss a video. So I hope we will see each other in the next video, and please remember, physics matters.